Well, I was born in Poland in a little town called Krynki, which nobody can understand where it is, but it's in the eastern part of Poland, near Russia, Lithuania, in fact. My father was absolutely devoted to me and showed me off at every opportunity. And I've got photos of him doing that, but all I've really got are photos. He was arrested by the Russians and taken to a prison in Russia. And when that happened, the Russian KGB came to get the family, the rest of his family. So one morning, or very early in the morning, there was a knocking on the door. Russian soldiers came in and they spoke to my mother and said, take what you can carry, take your children and come with us. There was no waiting around, thinking what to take, what not to take. She had to say goodbye to her parents, to all her loved ones, and frog marched to the trains. She took me, but she begged the Russian soldiers not to take my little sister because she wasn't healthy, and she thought she would die on the journey. So she pleaded and pleaded with them. Eventually they gave in and said, yes, that she could remain with my grandparents. So I went with her, and one of the things I've got in my possession is a blue pot. In fact, I've got it here, this little blue enamel pot, which my mother thought, having a baby, it would be useful to warm up something. So she grabbed hold of this pot, and it stayed with me ever since. We were led to the trains that were waiting at the station. They were cattle trains, just bare minimum. Nowhere to sit on except benches, nothing, no toilets. So these trains took us to Siberia. And that's where I spent my war years. The children were allowed to go to school. I remember the walks we used to go in the steppes. The teacher would take us to look for various things like plants and anything. And this has still stayed with me because whenever I walk, I usually look for stones or bits of wood or anything else that will be inspirational to me. And it's amazing how your background or your early life affects you later on. Who knows, maybe my little blue pot had something to do with my becoming a potter, I don't know. It's been such a big thing in my life. But the women were sent to do work in the fields. My mother gathered cow dung, which she then, with her bare feet, had to tread in to make it pliable enough for them to plaster the walls with it. She had to do manual labor. She always said, wait till I come home and I'll tell my family about it. You know, what hard work I'm doing. We were there till the end of the war, 45. We were allowed to go back then. And it wasn't until we got back then that my mother learned of what had happened to her family, to our family, because there was no news coming into where we were, no news. And my mother had no idea where her husband, my father, was. And my father, when he was in prison, had no idea where we were. So in fact, he was let out by the Russians much earlier, and he went to look for us in Poland, in the little town, Krynki, where we lived. And he got shot by the Germans. So we were told there was no way we could find out exactly what happened to him. It was just someone somewhere had seen him get shot. So that was His end. I never saw my father since the age of two. And my mother had a very short marriage because they got married and had two children, and then it all ended.
The rest of her family?
Well, they were all sent to Treblinka, where no one survived. The reason why we're alive and my mother's alive is because of Siberia. You know, that was what saved us. And the cruel thing is that she begged them to leave my little sister. And the guilt that she must have felt all these years that she'd left her there with the grandparents, meaning the best, because nobody was to know what was awaiting. How could anyone know of the horrors that were there? My father had a brother who went to Australia before the war, and he managed to get us papers. And that was my first country of freedom. And I'd never believe, I just kept saying to my mother, will there be flowers there? Because I was very much into nature. And she said, yes, I mean, Australia and flowers, you know, it's one of the... But when I came to Australia, I went to school, learned English, and then went on to high school, which was a very good school, McRobertson Girls High School. And there I had a wonderful art teacher who inspired me to take up art. And then I went to study art at a college, art college. So I really started painting before I did any pottery at all. My artistic side was always there. I can't remember never creating something. Faces are things that show an awful lot of expression of yourself. And I think it's a reflection of the past and the faces that I've known and lost. So they were never faces that were particularly happy. They were sad and wistful, and probably what I felt inside. But they were not of real people, they were just made up faces that I've always had a feeling for. Torsos I loved making because I've always drawn. I've been going to life classes ever since I've been painting and potting. And I love the form, the body, and especially Greek torsos I'm very attached to. I find that putting a head on a torso somehow distracts from the torso. So I make heads separately and I make torsos separately. I love the beginnings, the way it starts from a piece of lump of clay, and you just see it evolve and grow and grow, and it almost takes a life of its own. You don't really sometimes have control of it. I more or less have an idea that it's going to start round and end up closed or open, but I'm never sure how it's actually going to evolve. And I don't use glazes because they cover up the marks. And I believe in showing all the marks of the fingers or tools you've used. To me, that's very important because it shows the maker. So I never use glazes. I use
natural
materials like oxides to get my colors. A lot of it is accidental, because when you've made something, the next step is the kiln. And that can be either your friend or your enemy. Lots of things go on in there that you can't control. It's not like an artist who's got a brush and his paint and he can carry on working until he gets the desired effect. With ceramics, you put it in that kiln and all sorts of things can happen, from breakages to clay, the glaze getting stuck to the shell, and distortions as well. Certain pots get distorted there. And this, what you think you've done isn't necessarily what ends up the same. Sometimes you're pleasantly surprised, and sometimes you could just cry. Most of those are landscapes, slab pots. So again, my first love of painting has, it in fact, transcended to my pots, because the pots are landscapes of either moonscape, seascape, mountains, the lay of the land when you fly over a country, over the fields, and you have it almost like a quilt of colors. And that too has always inspired me, the shapes and colors. And if you look at a pot on there, which is half finished, it hasn't been glazed, the one on the stand, that's ready to go into the kiln to be biscuit fired. So once it goes into the biscuit firing, it changes again. And if you look carefully, you can see the rise of mountains, sky, and that feel of the landscape is always present in most of my work. I do plates. I do big plates, but they too have a feel of landscape. In fact, one I had, people called it the Australian plate because it reminded them of the outback. Now, it wasn't intentional, but it's what people see in work that I find so exciting, you know, that they looked at this plate and they said, my God, that looks just like the outback. I still thought my father would turn up one day, and hoping against hope that he would. Whenever I needed, I would draw, paint, or make things, and it's always kept me going. You know, other people might have succumbed to depression and other things, but I've always had this outlet, and people have said I'm very lucky to be able to do that. And especially now, getting older, it's still a tremendous thing to be able to do. I'll be like Lucy Reed, I hope. She went on till 90.